Well, something special tonight. We begin a series of reports on the propositions California voters will be deciding next month. We begin with the two initiatives that deal with taxes, education, and the state budget.
KCRA3's David Bienick has been working the last several days to kind of decipher the workings of Props 30 and 38, and it can be kind of confusing, David.
Yeah, Kelly, here's what we came up with after reading and rereading Governor Brown's Proposition 30, the tax measure. We came up with where the money comes from and where it goes. Pretty simple, huh? Yeah, well, if you're like me, we took our colored markers, we headed over to UC Davis, and we did this to try to help you understand.
So let's begin by discussing where the money for Prop 30 would come from. And it basically is going to come from two sets of sources. One source is going to be the sales tax. It would raise the sales tax in California by 1/4 cent for the next 4 years. The other source of funding for Prop 30 is the income tax. The income tax provision would apply to anybody in California who's making more than $250,000 a year, or for couples, anybody who's making more than $500,000 a year. And the nonpartisan legislative analyst has said that basically that amounts to the top 1% of the tax filers in California. This part of the provision would last 7 years. And even though a lot more people pay sales tax than would pay the income tax part of Prop 30 is actually the part that provides most of the funding. The money from these two sources would go into something called the Education Protection Account, or the EPA. This is basically a new fund that would be created, and it would generate roughly $6 billion a year. I say roughly because this initiative relies so much on upper-level income earners' income taxes, the amount could actually vary quite widely from 1 year to another. Now, because the EPA is considered part of the state budget, the part of the state, California state law known as Prop 98 would apply. Prop 98 is basically the escalator of California education funding. Every time there's new revenues, the guaranteed amount for education goes up. So that means that Prop 30 money, or at least some of it, would have to go for education. And in this case, education means K through 14 schools in California. K through 14 schools are, of course, K through 12 schools, elementary, middle, and high schools, both public, traditional public, and charter schools. It's also the community college system in California. That's where the 14 comes from in K through 14. But Prop 30 money from the EPA would also go directly into the state budget for lawmakers to basically use how they wanted to. How much would the amounts be? Well, we know that out of the money that K through 14 education would get, that the K through 12 schools would be guaranteed 89% of the funding, and for the community college, their share would be 11%. In the current year budget, which assumes that Prop 30 is going to pass, they factored these in. So we know the numbers for 2012 and in 2013. K through 12 schools will get $2.6 billion. Community colleges will get $0.3 billion. And the rest of the state budget actually gets the lion's share of Prop 30 funding in the first year at $5.6 billion. That all adds up to an additional $8.5 billion in the first year that Prop 30 would be in effect. So all of this assumes that Prop 30 is going to pass, but lawmakers have also come up with consequences for if it fails. Basically, what happens if voters say no? And in that case, they've instituted what are going to be called trigger cuts. These add up to somewhere in the neighborhood of $5.9 billion in the current state budget. And three areas get hit. They are K through 14 education, the UC and CSU systems, and the other parts of the state budget. K through 14 schools would lose $5.3 billion out of the current state budget. UC and CSU would lose a combined total of a $500 million, or $500 million, and the rest of the state budget would lose $0.1 billion. There is one other part of Prop 30 that has nothing to do with the taxes and the structure that we've talked about so far. It has to do with prison realignment. In 2011, the state began transferring responsibility for some of its state inmates to local jails. This guarantees that the state funding for those inmates also follows the people. The one thing that we can't show you with this diagram is what happens after these taxes run out, in 4 years in the case of the sales tax and 7 years in the case of the income tax. That will be left up to future legislators and future voters.
Huh. I should point out that the Prop 30 supporters say that actually during the first year that education will get most of the money, but both sides do agree on one thing, that this is complicated. With the multiple moving parts, for everything from the EPA to the trigger cuts, it's very complicated. And now we can compare that to the competing initiative, Prop 38, sponsored by Molly Munger, that attorney out of Los Angeles. That looks like this when we spread it out on the big board behind us. We're going to be taking a look at this, breaking it down step by step on Wednesday.
Wow. So, Professor Bienick, can you give us a little preview of Prop 38?
Well, one big thing you might notice is that there's just one funding source for Prop 38 compared to the two funding sources that there are. There is more strings attached to this money, exactly where it has to go, and it lasts nearly twice as long as Prop 30.
Okay. Very illustrative.
If this journalism thing doesn't work out, David, you need to fill that classroom
up with
students. That was great. Thanks, David. Well, take a look at how Proposition works here at your own speed. You can do all this if you didn't catch it all. Just go to our website, kcra.com. David's obviously been working pretty hard on this, and you can just click through there to watch it again. We have a slideshow under the featured section of the left-hand side of the homepage. We've broken it all down, the graphics one by one, to illustrate where the money comes from and where it'll go, all to make things easier for you when you go to the polls. Of course, you can also get ready for Election Day by downloading our brand new election app. It's free if you have an Android or an Apple mobile device. Just search for Commitment 2012 in iTunes or Google Play.